All right, so let's start. So today, two unrelated topics. One is regarding your West syndrome update, which was given out by our Neurology Academy. And the second one, totally unrelated, it is HHHFNC. So we will read West syndrome first. Hope all of you have your articles ready. All right, so if this question is asked, which has a high chance of being asked because this is an update, right? So start with an introduction. Introduction will be, West syndrome is an age-dependent epileptic encephalopathy. All words are important, okay? So age-dependent epileptic encephalopathy, okay? So this is secondary to some brain injury. This is not a diagnosis in itself. You can call it as a symptom. Just like you say seizure is a symptom, just like you say status epilepticus is a symptom, just like you say fever is a symptom, this spasm or West syndrome, you can consider it as a symptom and you have to find out the cause. Why? The etiology carries importance for prognosis. So you have to write this is secondary to brain injury. The brain injury can happen in prenatal, natal, or postnatal period. It could be anything. Similar to your cerebral palsy definition, you remember injury to developing brain. So similar to that. That is why the importance of asking for history of infantile spasm in a child who is already having developmental delay. Especially if the child is coming to you for follow-up on immunization at 6 weeks and 10 weeks, ask them if the child is having something like an infantile spasm. So that brings us to our next question. What is a spasm and is it still called as infantile spasm? No. Infantile spasm is an old term. Now, infantile spasm has been replaced with epileptic spasm. Okay, that is the new terminology. It is not infantile spasm. It is epileptic spasm. And there are many, many definitions. Many, many definitions. If you look into the article, you will see multiple definitions in box one. All right, page, second page, you will see multiple definitions. How to remember all of them? Remember only few important ones. First is a clinical spasm. What is a clinical spasm? The physical manifestation of this convulsion. So they have defined it as brief. Brief as in it lasts only 2 seconds, not more than 2 seconds, 0.5 to 2 seconds. Brief, synchronous movements involving, it can be anything. It can be head, it can be trunk, it can be limbs or all together. All right. Lasting for around 1 second, 0.5 to 2 seconds. And this movement can be flexor or extensor. Again, this is important because as soon as you think about this epileptic spasm, for want of new word, you always think of salam spells, isn't it? So baby coming forward like this and going back. This is the classical salam spell that you discuss, isn't it? So this is how it is described. That remember, it can also be extensor. It need not be just flexor. It can also be extensor. Or it can be a mixed variety. It can be symmetric or asymmetric. Finding that out is important because asymmetric spasms, if you find out an epileptic focus, it is amenable for surgery. Hence, the importance of symmetric or asymmetric. All right. And this can be waxing and waning. Waxing and waning, especially in relation to your sleep-wake cycle. All right. So, immediately when the child gets up or just before the child goes to sleep, it is associated with these spasms and they occur in clusters. So these are all the terms that we have described are important. Okay, it is brief, it is synchronous, it can involve head, trunk and limbs or alone or together. It occurs in clusters, it's related to sleep-wake cycle and it can be flexor or extensor or mixed. Okay, so this is a clinical spasm. Suppose this clinical spasm is associated with an EEG finding suggestive of an epilepsy, any epileptiform discharge, then you called as an epileptic spasm. Okay, so with EEG finding, it is called as epileptic spasm. If this epileptic spasm is associated with classical hip arrhythmia, All right. So this epileptic spasm in clusters, if it is associated with hips arrhythmia, you call it as West syndrome. If it is not associated with hips arrhythmia, not associated with variants of hips arrhythmia, then you call it as epileptic spasms without hips arrhythmia. As simple as that. These are the definitions. If you remember this much, it is enough. I request all participants to please mute so we don't have a problem when others listen to the same lecture. So these are the definitions. So what are the consensus statements that is given out by our neurology department? Before we go into that, one important point. How do you differentiate this from a myoclonic jerk? Because myoclonic jerk typically looks very, 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 very similar to your infantile spasm. So you will differentiate by infantile spasm being of longer duration by having a tonic component. Okay. Either, see, remember, if you flexor, this, there's going to be a tonic component in infantile spasm, whereas myoclonic jerk is going to be this, right? So there's a difference. So there's a longer duration in infantile spasm. There's a tonic component in infantile spasm, and it occurs in clusters and in relation to sleep-wake cycle. So these are the four points that are going to differentiate an infantile spasm. These are the features of spasm compared to that of your myoclonic jerk. Okay, so epileptic spasm. We have to get used to calling it epileptic spasm. We have been calling it infantile spasm for so long. Right. So these are the definitions. This is the first consensus statement. Then third page, if you see etiology, they have not given anything in particular. If you can recall the etiologies of your cerebral palsy, you can write. You will not be wrong. All right, because it's going to be same. Infectious, ischemic, inflammatory, traumatic, genetic, metabolic. Simple. Okay, so it's easy enough to remember. Just write two causes for each and you'll be done. Next, coming to diagnosis of West syndrome. So here what consensus they have given is, so this is the flowchart that they have given in our article. All right, how to remember this? This is not very difficult. Okay, I'll make it simplified. If a child is presenting with clinical spasm with the EEG findings of hips arrhythmia, then it is West syndrome. If a child is presenting with clinical spasm, but you are not finding hips arrhythmia on EEG, then you do a overnight EEG. Try to find out hips arrhythmia, or you repeat the EEG 2 weeks later, trying to find a hips arrhythmia. So your point is to try to document hips arrhythmia. Suppose in another scenario, okay, Dr. JP has asked, what was that about symmetry? See, this epileptic spasm can be symmetric or asymmetric. Asymmetric as in it can be focal. Okay, so instead of both limbs going forward, maybe just one limb comes forward with all other features of spasm. So in that case, if a focal seizure is there, you will look for focality in brain. If you find that focality either by MRI or by a PET scan, then you will try to isolate that and remove it via surgery. It is amenable to surgical treatment, epileptic surgery. That is why you need to document what sort of clinical spasm it is. And that is why you need to find out the etiology. Because etiology carries important prognosis. All right, we'll discuss about that. Don't worry. Right, where were we? Diagnosis, right. So if this child has come to you for something else, you do a EEG and you find out hips arrhythmia, but no history is forthcoming of clinical spasm, then you request the parents to record a video throughout their home stay to find if the baby is having subtle spasms, or you can admit the child to do a video EEG. So you can clinically see if it is correlated with the EEG findings, clinical findings with EEG findings, whether it is correlated, you'll be able to make out. So this is the consensus statement for EEG, and this is what is given in your flowchart. So if you see, if the history and home videos are consistent with epileptic spasms, then you look for etiology. Simultaneously do a EEG to find out hips arrhythmia. If there is hips arrhythmia or its variant, then consider it as West syndrome and start treatment. Then try to find out the etiology. You will look at MRI brain to find out what has resulted in this infantile spasm. If you are able to find out the cause, then you will try to see if that cause is treatable or not. See, if MRI is normal or it is not showing any changes, then you will think about genetic testing. Then you might think about PET scanning, especially if the spasms are focal. Because MRI can miss certain things, but PET scan may not. Okay, especially focal cortical dysplasias may be picked up by your PET scan, and that will be amenable for epileptic surgery. If the MRI brain is showing some abnormality, and that abnormality is suggestive of a metabolic etiology or some metabolic abnormality, you will try to work up for inborn errors of metabolism. Simple. So this is the flowchart. Next, how are you going to do this EEG? That is the next consensus statement. This is the classical hips arrhythmia. All right. So this is the classical hips arrhythmia. Hips arrhythmia is high voltage, completely disorganized, chaotic pattern. You will not be able to make out any pattern. You will not be able to make out specific amplitude, specific frequency. It's going to be like the scribbling of a 15-month-old. Okay, so that is another point. 15-month-old baby starts scribbling. Remember that. Development. Right. So EEG, how are you going to do the EEG? Basic level. Okay. So basic level EEG, standard EEG, the 10-20 point system where we discussed in previous class, right? EEG in pediatric epilepsy. So 10-20 system along with three EMG electrodes. Where are they going to connect the EMG electrodes? They want to look if there is actually a clinical spasm. Okay, so they are trying to document it. They're going to connect one to neck and two to deltoids. Okay, so they will connect that and do a EEG. How long are they going to do a EEG? Minimum for 30 minutes along with 10 minutes at least post waking. Why post waking? Because epileptic spasm is associated with sleep wake cycle. So at least this much time they will be able to see. Suppose this EEG is not offering you any specific hips arrhythmias, then what are you going to do? Next, you will go for an advanced EEG, because our aim is to document hips arrhythmia and confirm West syndrome so that you can initiate treatment as early as possible. If a child is coming to you with some history suggestive of clinical spasm, it is the onus is on the pediatrician to do an EEG within 24 to 48 hours of the child presenting to you. So you confirm the diagnosis and initiate treatment as early as possible. Right. What is advanced level EEG? Advanced level EEG is you doing it for a longer time, as simple as that. So if you have an inpatient facility, then you can do a continuous EEG monitoring. Okay, 24 hours, you can do a EEG monitoring. You can connect the EMG and do all that. Suppose inpatient facility is not available, then what you can do is 2 to 4 hours of EEG along with this 2 to 4 hours of EEG capturing is usually during sleep. Usually during non-REM sleep, stage 2, ideally. All of this requires a lot of planning with the parent and the child, because it's very difficult to get young infants to get to sleep or get to eat at the time you want at your convenience. It has to be done at their convenience, not yours. So 2 to 4 hours of EEG, preferably in stage 2 REM sleep, followed by at least 30 minutes post-waking. Why am I stressing on this sleep? The importance of sleep is this. Initially, this hips arrhythmia variant or hips arrhythmia starts the EEG abnormality, background abnormality exists during sleep alone. Only as the child grows, it comes into the awake period as well. That is why it is important to do a sleep EEG where you record your hips arrhythmia findings. So based upon this clinical and EEG, you can divide into confirmed West syndrome, probable West syndrome, and possible West syndrome. Confirmed is clinical is also present, EEG of hips arrhythmia or variant is also present. Your probable West syndrome is where clinical is suggestive, but EEG we are not sure because hips arrhythmia pattern is not there, some other epileptic form discharge is there. Possible is very unlikely because clinical also you do not have, EEG also you do not have. So that much you can remember. So this is the next consensus guidelines where you do EEG for suspected West syndrome. Hips arrhythmia, if you see in page 3, last they have described the hips arrhythmia. High voltage, disorganized, chaotic pattern. Okay, consisting of random spikes and slow waves. And these vary from moment to moment. And next sentence is, it's initially during drowsiness and light sleep, but then becomes more during wake cycle. All right. Then hips arrhythmia variant. I kept on telling something like hips arrhythmia variant. The reason being, hips arrhythmia may be absent in 33% of people. They do not show hips arrhythmia. All right. So for them, you need to know the variants. There are multiple variants that are described. Rapid, slow, asymmetric, birth suppression patterns. There are multiple patterns. If you know these variants, then only you'll be able to classify them into West syndrome. Otherwise, they go undiagnosed. Isn't it so? And again, asymmetric hips arrhythmias constitute 23%. It is important to find out focal hemispheric abnormalities, especially in asymmetric spasm, because you'll be able to treat it by surgery. All right. Then ictal EEG, there are three phases that are described. Okay, so whatever we discuss now, this hips arrhythmia, all of those are inter-ictal EEG. Not during the convulsion, it is after the convulsion or before the convulsion, whichever way you want to look at it. Usually it is after. So ictal EEG, there are three phases. Okay, so first phase, So ictal EEG, first phase, what happens is a diffuse, high amplitude, slow wave that happens. Okay. Second phase, there is a low amplitude, but fast wave. And third phase, there is a diffuse flattening that happens, which is called as an electro-decremental response. Okay, all of these, even though it is described like three phases, it happens very, very fast. It is not going to last long. It is the total three things together lasts for maximum 5 seconds, not more than that. It is 1 to 5 seconds. So remember that. So this is ictal EEG during an epileptic spasm. This is what you are going to find. Okay. So EEG we completed. So what do you, why do you do EEG? How do you do EEG? What are the findings you expect in EEG during ictal period and interictal period? Next, coming to imaging studies. Imaging studies, why are you going to do MRI? You are going to do MRI so that you will be able to find out the reason, the etiology. Okay, and when are you going to do MRI? Preferably before starting therapy. Why before starting therapy? Because if the etiology varies, treatment varies. Which etiology am I talking about specifically? It is tuberous sclerosis. Why? Rest of the epileptic spasms, you treat with ACTH or prednisolone as the first line of treatment. Whereas for tuberous sclerosis, it is vigabatrin, which is the first line of treatment. So if you find classical findings of tuberous sclerosis like candle wax dripping appearance, then you consider starting your vigabatrin compared to your ACTH or prednisolone. Hence, the importance. And also, why before starting treatment? See, if you initiate treatment with ACTH, what happens in MRI? You will find findings of suggestive of cortical atrophy. Suppose you start vigabatrin. What happens? Vigabatrin will show, in itself will show some T2 abnormalities apart from underlying problems. So you will not know whether the problem is due to the underlying etiology or secondary to the medication that you have started. Got my point? So hence, it is always important to start before you start treatment. So when are you going to consider a repeat MRI? So repeat MRI you will do in only 4 situations. All right, very simple. So if you are unable to find out the cause initially, okay, so initially MRI is normal, but you strongly suspect that there could be something going on. Or, so when will you repeat? That is another question. See, ideally you will repeat it at around 24 months. Why this 24 months? Why this 2-year period? Because by then, most of the myelination would have happened. So you will be able to find out what is happening inside properly. Suppose you have started treatment and you want to document there is no hips arrhythmia. Then you will, I'm talking about repeat EEG, isn't it so? All right, fine. I'm extremely sorry. MRI you will do at 24 months if the initial MRI is normal. This is the modality of choice. Repeat MRI only if the initial thing is normal. All right. You will do it with 3 Tesla, epilepsy protocol you will do. And whatever special MRIs that you can remember, recall, you can put your MRS, you can put your STIR sequence, you can put SPGR sequence, you can put whichever you can remember, you can do those MRIs. So this is about MRI. Repeat EEG, I think I'll have to talk about, isn't it? So I forgot that. So repeat EEG or EEG you will do, one, yes, to find out the cause you will do, because you need to document hips arrhythmia. Where should I write EEG? Yeah, I'll write it here. So EEG to diagnose hips arrhythmia, easy to document stopping of hips arrhythmia. Then you will do EEG if there is suspicion of additional change that is happening. This is also possible. The child may initially start as having epileptic spasm with hips arrhythmia and then go on to have other epileptiform discharges. So if you have a suspicion of that, then you do. So secondary seizure type developing, you will do. And if there is no clinical improvement and you want to find out what is happening, then you do. So these are the four indications where you do a repeat EEG. So EEG is done, MRI is done, when you do, how you do, what you do, why you do. So MRI, suppose say you are not able to find out any cause or you found out something that is suggestive of metabolic problem. Then you will do a metabolic evaluation. Okay, that is the next consensus guideline. So what are the metabolic evaluations you will do? Whatever you can remember, you can put. All right, there are up to 25 IEMs that can present as an infantile spasm or epileptic spasm. And you look for all of those. When do you suspect a metabolic cause? If there is a family history of sibling death, family history of intellectual disability, if there is hepatosplenomegaly in this child who is presenting to you with some tonal abnormalities, or initial period being okay and later child deteriorated, these are findings that will suggest that this is a metabolic problem. All right. So this is important. So this you need to know. And investigation you will do by your IEM, tandem mass spectrometry, then your urine for organic acids, mitochondrial workup, all of those you will do. Excuse me. And last but not least, in metabolic evaluation, never forget your GLUT. GLUT is your glucose transporting receptor. Okay. So glucose transporting receptor defect, you will do a simple evaluation. 4 hours fast, you will check to see ratio between plasma and CSF glucose. So homework for you, real homework. Okay, I'm not kidding. I want you guys to find out how a GLUT receptor defect will present and how are you going to diagnose a GLUT receptor defect. Just out of interest, not for exam going PGs. Exam going PGs, leave it. Rest, you can find out and let me know in Telegram group. So next, if metabolic evaluation is normal, what is left out is your genetic evaluation. All right. So genetic evaluation you will do by complete exome sequencing you can do, or complete genome sequencing you can do. Whole genome sequencing or whole exome sequencing. Sometimes diagnostic yield is not that good. It's usually less than 60 to 50%. But still, if you are able to find a cause, you'll be able to prognosticate. You'll be able to do prenatal diagnostic testing if it comes to that. So genetic testing, if history, clinical exam or MRI is suggestive of a genetic disorder, or if the child is having dysmorphism clinically, or there's a previous history that is suggestive that it could be a genetic etiology and previously workup was not done. So you will do a microarray, your whole exome sequencing, or your whole genome sequencing, depending upon what you are suspecting. If you suspect that it is going to be hereditary, it is always better to do whole exome sequencing in trios. What do I mean by trios? Trios is where you do for the child, the mother, and the father, all of them. Okay, so this is as far as genetic evaluation is done. See, in this update, they have given more and more and more importance to trying to find out the etiology. If you see, that is what you are doing, isn't it? So you made a diagnosis with clinical spasm and EEG finding, but then you are going on to find the etiology with your MRI, etiology with your genetic evaluation, and similarly etiology with your PET scan also comes. Okay. So now that you have found out, how are you going to treat this child? So treatment is simple. So you found out the etiology. If the etiology is a tuberous sclerosis complex, the first line of drug is vigabatrin. You will do a reassessment at 2 weeks to see if clinically the child has responded, EEG wise the child has responded. If clinical has stopped, EEG has stopped, then you will continue vigabatrin for 6 months. This is important. Okay. So vigabatrin continuation will go for 6 months after resolution of your hips arrhythmia. The revaluation will be done at 2 weeks after starting vigabhadram. What about non-tuberous sclerosis associated epileptic spasm? You will start with ACTH or high dose prednisolone. What is high dose ACTH? It is 150 units per meter square body surface area. High dose prednisolone is 4 mg per kg. And you will give this and reassess at 2 weeks. What you will reassess? Clinical and EEG resolution. If both have resolved, you will taper off hormonal therapy in 2 to 4 weeks. Remember that. Vigabatrin is for 6 months, whereas your hormonal therapy, you will taper off in 2 to 4 weeks. Suppose in either of them, when you evaluate at 2 weeks, you find that the clinical spasm is persisting or EEG is showing persistence of hip arrhythmia, what are you going to do? You will initiate the other hormonal therapy or other anti-epileptic drugs in case of your tuberous sclerosis associated. If it is non-tuberous sclerosis associated, then you can consider vigabatrin as second line for non-tuberous sclerosis associated also. And if it is not responding to vigabatrin, then other anti-epileptic drugs. What other anti-epileptic drugs will be advised? You can give benzodiazepine. You can give sodium valproate. You can give topiramate. You can give zonisamide. Okay. So this is the treatment protocol. Suppose clinical spasm is fine, but EEG is showing not hip arrhythmia, but some epileptiform discharges. Then again, you will taper off the initial drug. And if the child is going to have some clinical presentation of seizures, then you will think about initiating other anti-epileptic drugs. So this is the next consensus guidelines. The consensus first line treatment, they have described how to give your ACTH, 150 international units per meter square of body surface area, is preferred compared to low dose. Similarly, prednisolone high dose is preferred to low dose. And whenever you give these steroids, it is important for us to follow up to look for steroid toxicity. It is important for you to make sure if the child has any intercurrent illness, you are supposed to give stress dose steroids. All right. When do you consider stress dose steroids? If the child is on systemic steroids for more than 2 consecutive, Child is on steroids for more than 2 consecutive or 3 cumulative weeks. Okay. Weeks, not months, weeks on steroids in the past 6 months. Then this child is at risk for adrenal insufficiency whenever there is a stress. Hence, you need to supplement with stress dose steroids. How much are you going to give? 25 to 100 mg per meter square of hydrocortisone. This is your stress dose steroid. Again, the stress dose steroid is a repeatedly asked question in your practicals and Viva OSE. So, important to remember when you are going to give your stress dose steroid. Vigabatrin, when you are going to give, what are you going to monitor? You are worried about vision. All right. So vision is what you are going to monitor by electroretinography. So this is about vigabatrin. Vigabatrin dosage is 50 mg per kg per day. Okay. Vigabatrin 50 mg per kg per day you will give. You will keep increasing it by 50 mg per kg per day. Per day in Solokudade, every 50 mg per kg per 50 mg per kg every 3 to 7 days till a maximum dose of 150 mg per kg is achieved. Okay, within 2 weeks, you are supposed to achieve this maximum dose of 150 mg per kg via vigabatrin. And the vigabatrin duration is 6 months. Hormonal therapy, remember, if everything is fine, EEG is fine, your clinical spasm is fine. The meeting will end in 10 minutes. Achicho, we have not completed this at all. All right, don't go. I will send another link to Telegram once we are done with this. Okay, we will do HHFNC also and we'll finish it off. This is one big problem in Zoom. So this is about vigabatrin. And your protocol is if this child is on tuberous sclerosis, child is on vigabatrin. If the child is not responding, you will start other anti-epileptic drugs. Correct? What are the other anti-epileptic drugs that we discussed? you will start on either benzodiazepine or valproate or zonisamide. Okay, and there's no difference between these. Almost all are similar in studies. If the child is non-tuberous sclerosis, you will start on ACTH or steroids, prednisolone. If the child is not responding, then you can start on vigabatrin. If the child is again not responding, then you can consider other antiepileptic drugs. Simpler to remember this way. Last but not least, in treatment of infantile spasm is your dietary therapy. Dietary therapy, remember just 2 points. If the patient is affordable and it is palatable for the child, then ketogenic diet can be tried. Ketogenic diet. If ketogenic diet is not possible or it's becoming very costly for the parents or in low resource settings, then modified Atkins diet can be done. Okay, modified Atkins diet can be done. Dietary therapy you should try for at least 3 months before telling it is effective or not effective. And if it is going to be effective, then continue it for at least 2 years. That's all. That's all we are done with your consensus guidelines on West syndrome. So if this question is asked, what are you going to do? Just let's recall fast. You are going to talk about the definition. Okay. You will say what is West syndrome, what are clinical spasms, what are epileptic spasms, what is West syndrome, and why is it important for us to diagnose West syndrome. Then you can tell consensus guidelines wise, how are you going to diagnose it? All right. And the importance of finding out the etiology can be put in diagnosis. So you will talk about EEG. In etiology, you will talk about why we do MRI, how we do MRI. So always remember when, what, where, how. So if these questions are answered, then it should be enough. Then genetic testing. Then metabolic testing. All right. Then you can put PET scan also in etiology itself. In treatment, you can talk about the anti-epileptic drugs, diet, and epileptic surgery. 1 point can be added. That's all. If this question is asked in whatever way, you can do. What to monitor in vigabatrin is your visual acuity. Your retinal toxicity is classical. Vigabatrin, how do you remember? Vigabatrin. Right? So this is a GABA transaminase inhibitor. Okay? TR transaminase. IN is inhibitor. VI is for vision. Vision toxicity will be present. So in order to monitor, you will do a electroretinogram. All right. So ERG, electroretinogram, visual field defects will be seen. Correct. So this is about West syndrome. Whichever way they ask, write these. I think this should be more than enough for a 5 mark or a 10 mark question. Also your practicals. If a child is presenting with West syndrome, infantile spasm like presentation, pakka these questions will be asked. So let us sign out now. Okay. I will send another link to Telegram. Sorry for taking so long. Or should I do the HSFNC class tomorrow? If that is fine, we will do that also, because I think this has taken 40 minutes. Isn't it so? Today itself, we'll finish off. HFNC, RNC, JP. All right. So let's sign out. Thank you for listening to me. I'll send the link. Sorry for taking such a long time.